Hello everyone, my name is Nadeem Khan. Welcome to Uncommon Literature. Today we are going to learn The Rime of the Ancient Mariner by Samuel Taylor Coleridge. Before moving to the poem, let us first try to understand something about the poem. Actually, Wordsworth and Coleridge were friends and both are romantic poets. They decided to choose their own topics of poems. So Wordsworth decided his own topic to write about nature, and Coleridge decided that he would write on the supernatural. So in this poem there are so many elements which are supernatural. So if you find any supernatural element here, so don't get shocked. So let us move. So the poem is divided into seven parts, and I have divided this poem in seven parts only. Like we will make we will study one part at a time and then we will move to the next part. So let us start. It is an ancient mariner and he stopped one of three. Basically, before moving to the poem, you have to understand what is happening here. So there is an ancient mariner. By ancient mariner we mean that the mariner, or mariner means sailor, that there is an old sailor. The first line says there is an old sailor and he stopped one of three. So this sailor, this mariner, stops one of the three wedding guests. So there is some wedding going on in nearby area and the mariner has stopped one of the guests. Why? Let us see. By thy long grey beard and glittering eye, now whereof stopped thou me? These two lines are spoken by the guest himself, that he is asking that mariner who has long grey beard and glittering eye, why you are stopping me? The bridegroom's doors are opened wide and I am next of kin. Meaning, he is saying that the bridegroom has just come and his doors are open. Everybody is going to celebrate the wedding now. And I am a close relative. I am next of kin means I am a close relative and I have to be in the wedding. The guests are met, the feast is set, may hear the merry din. So last two lines also related to the wedding only, that he is saying that all the guests have come and the feast is also set, the food is also ready and every decoration, everything is ready. So, and he can also hear the merry din. Merry means happy, din means sound. So from the wedding he can also hear the happy sound. He holds him with his skinny hand. He is here used for the mariner. So the mariner has held him with his hand and he started telling his own story. Listen, in the next line, there was a ship, quoth he. Quoth he means said he. So he started his telling his story. So hold off, unhand me, grey beard loon, eftsoons his hand dropped he. So by this, as soon as the mariner held the hand of the guest, what happened? He started telling the story by saying there was a ship. But here the guest has demanded that his hand should be left and he wanted that he should unhand him. Okay, like he should leave his hand, and he is calling him grey beard loon. Loon means a crazy person, a mad person, grey beard person. And at the same time he left his, or the mariner dropped his hand. Eftsoons means at the same time or very soon he dropped his hand. He holds him with his glittering eye. So notice this line, that as soon as he left his hand, he holds him by his glittering eye. So there is a sort of hypnotism. You can see that the mariner has hypnotized the guest by his glittering eyes. The wedding guest stood still. By the hold of the glittering eyes, the wedding guest is completely still now and listens like a 3 years child. द मैरिनर हैथ हिज विल. सो बाय द कैप्चर ऑफ हिज ग्लिटरिंग आई द वेडिंग गेस्ट हैज कंप्लीटली बिकम स्टिल एंड लिसनिंग लाइक ए 3 year ओल्ड चाइल्ड. एंड द लास्ट लाइन द मैरिनर हैथ हिज विल मीनिंग दैट नाउ द मैरिनर what he wanted has become true, like his wish has been fulfilled. So the wedding guest sat on a stone, very simple line, he cannot choose but hear, meaning that he does not have any other choice but he has to listen what mariner is trying to tell him. And thus spake, meaning spoke, and thus spoke on that ancient man. So here he started, the mariner started speaking to the old man. Old man here is used for the old guest, wedding guest, the bright-eyed mariner. So the bright-eyed mariner started speaking. So let's see what he is telling. The ship was cheered, the harbor cleared, merrily did we drop, below the kirk, below the hill, below the lighthouse top. So he is going to tell us a story about his journey on a ship when he with his other sailors went to the South Pole, and what experience he had there he would tell us. Okay, so he has started telling his story by saying that ship was cheered. So everybody was very happy, the harbor cleared, the harbor, you must be knowing harbor, so it was clear to so that the ship could move. Merrily did we drop, so they were very happy when they started the journey. Below the kirk, below the hill, below the lighthouse top. So below the kirk means church, below the hill, so the hill you already know and lighthouse you also know. So basically they passed all these places, the church, the hill and the lighthouse, which was on the top of a mountain. The sun came up upon the left. So by this line you can understand that if the sun is rising from the left, they are moving towards the south. Out of the sea came he. So the word he, the pronoun he, is used for the sun. So sun is personified here because the sun is being addressed as a person. So out of the sea came he, and he shone bright, and on the right went down into the sea. So obviously if the sun is rising from the left, and it will definitely go down into the right side, and it is going into the sea. So it is coming out of the sea and going into the sea. So you can understand they are in the mid of an ocean. So there is nothing, though there is no land, only water everywhere. Higher and higher every day till over the mast at noon. So these lines are also related to the sun. So the sun is moving higher and higher every day. So why it is happening? That they are going towards the equator now. They are near the equator. So that is why at noon the sun is at the 90 degree. The sun is over the mast. Till over the mast at noon. The wedding guest here beat his breast, for he heard the loud bassoon. So the wedding guest here, you know, started demanding to go and beating his breast, like he is beating his chest and wanting to go, because he heard the loud bassoon sound. So bassoon is a sort of instrument. He heard the sound of this instrument from the wedding. Okay, the bride hath paced into the hall, red as a rose is she. Why the instrument was played? Because the bride has come now, okay, into the wedding hall, and she is as red as a rose. So this is a simile in this line. Nodding their heads before her goes the merry minstrelsy. So by this, nodding their heads means basically you can understand that the bride is coming now to the wedding hall, and she is as red as a rose, and there are singers and musicians along her. They are playing music. Okay, minstrels means singers or musicians. The wedding guest, he beat his breast, yet he cannot choose but hear. So obviously he is beating his breast, he is wanting to, you know, move away from the story which mariner is telling him, but yet he did not have any choice. so he has to hear. And thus spake on that ancient man, the bright-eyed mariner. So this is, these lines are being repeated. And now the storm blast came. So now the mariner is continuing his story, and he was tyrannous and strong. Now he is telling about that there was a storm, and it was very strong. He struck with his overtaking wings and chased us south along. So you can understand that here storm is also being personified, and a metaphor is also used for storm which is related to a bird, that is that it struck with his overtaking wings. So it was very strong, and whatever blows it had, they have been related to the wings. Okay, and chased us south along. So they were moving towards the south, and the storm was also chasing us towards that direction. With sloping masts and dipping prow, as who pursued with yell and blow. So you have to understand here that there is a storm chasing them, and their masts are sloping. So mast is a sort of pole in the ship. They are sloping, they are bending, and the dipping prow. Prow is the front part of the ship. So the front part of the ship is going in the water. Okay, because of the storm. As and how it was, what, how it has been described to us, like the, like some enemy is chasing a man, and a man is moving and running forward and forward, and his head is bending towards the front side. Okay, this is the imagery here. As who pursued with yell and blow. So somebody who is pursued and he is running with yell and blow, still treads the shadow of his foe. So the foe means enemy. So enemy is so near that the shadow of the enemy is coming to the ship. Okay, and forward bends his head, and the man is like, this is the comparison, and the man is moving his head forwards. He has bent his head forward. And ship drove fast, loud roared the blast, and southward we fled. So the ship is also moving fast. The loud roar also came very loud. It was like a blast. And towards the south they fled. And now there came both mist and snow, and it grew wondrous cold, and ice mast high came floating by as green as emerald. So you have to understand here, they have reached near the south pole. That is why there is all mist, there is all snow, and it grew wondrous cold. It was very cold, and ice mast high, very high, it was higher till their mast, came floating by, and it was coming floating on the water. Remember, they are in the ocean. As green as emerald. So the ice color was green, and through the drifts the snowy clifts did send a dismal sheen. So you have to understand that all around there is ice, very high icebergs, and snowy cliffs means the icebergs, and they are showing, they are shining. Okay, in the night, but this shine is very sad, sorrowful. Dismal means sorrowful. So this is not a happy sight basically. Nor shapes of man nor beasts we ken. The ice was all between. You understand these lines, that there was no sign of a man, no sign of an animal as well, and they could not see animal or man because the ice was between them. So there was high iceberg which was obstructing their sight. The ice was here, the ice was there, the ice was all around. So when these lines are told to you, there is an intention behind it. What? That you could imagine the feelings of the mariner and the dismal scenery which in which they were at, they were, you know, living at that time. So the ice was everywhere. It cracked and growled and rolled and howled like noises in a swound. So basically the eyes is cracking and it is making so many sounds like cracked, growled, roared and howled. At length did cross an albatross. Through the fog it came. So here there is a bird which is an ocean bird, and it is known for its high flight. Okay, it is a bird that is called albatross, and it came through the fog. As if it had been a Christian soul, we hailed it in God's name. So, you know, in this this small scenario, which is very sad, sorrowful scene, the albatross came. And remember, this is the first living being which they could see in that landscape. So it came as a hope to them, and they perceived it as a Christian soul. Okay, we hailed it in God's name. So they understood it that the God has sent him. Moving ahead, it ate the food it never had eaten, and round it flew. So basically they called the bird and fed him food, and the food they had like on board, and this food the albatross had never eaten before. And round it flew. So the albatross used to fly round round and round the ship. The ice did split with a thunder fit, and the helmsman steered us through. So you can relate it like if the albatross is flying round and round, so because of his flying, the ice gave some way, and the helmsman means the person who drives the ship, so he steered us through. So through that iceberg, the crack or the way which has been created, the helmsman moved the ship through that, and a good south wind sprung up behind the albatross. Albatross did follow. So there is a good south wind, so the wind was good now, and it was behind them, and also albatross was also following them. And every day for food or play came to the mariner's hollow. So whenever the mariner called the albatross, it came for food, okay, or to play with them. In mist or cloud, on mast or shroud, it passed for vespers nine. Why? What is the meaning here? That it in mist, there is mist all around, or cloud, on mast or shroud, it passed for vespers nine. So you have to understand that the night scene is completely gloomy. There is a fog-like scenario. There is fog, there is smoke. Nothing is visible, and only the moon is shining. The rays of the, you know, shine of the moon are coming through that smoke. Okay, and sometimes the albatross used to come and perched, set for on mast or shroud. Shroud here is used for sail. Okay, of the ship. And vespers nine. Here you understand the meaning of vesper nine. Vesper is a sort of evening time prayer in churches. Okay, so there is an evening prayer in church that is called vesper, and vespers nine means a period of 9 days. Okay, so you have to notice that Coleridge is obsessed with the number nine. Okay, remember this point. I will just come back to this in the next part of the poem. While all the night through fog smoke white glimmered the white moonshine. So the moon is shining through the smoke. Okay, God save thee, ancient mariner. This line is said by the wedding guest. So he is saying, God save thee from the fiends that plague thee thus. So he is saying that may God bless you, may God save you from all the danger that you faced there. Why look thou so? So he is asking that he can see that some tension on the face of the mariner. So he is asking, what happened to you suddenly? What happened? Tell me. So mariner says, with my crossbow I shot the albatross. So with this the first part ends. So you can understand that here the first part ends with the suspense that the mariner shot the albatross with his crossbow. okay? So I hope you must have understood it, and I have added the link of the other parts of this poem in the description. So you can just go to the description and look at the other part of this poem. Thank you.